Maybe, I don't know, my square wheeler doesn't really make my own. But But you still got to come out and pick them all up. Now, the biggest difference is, of course, what everybody else is concerned about is they're not picking them up. So, as far as comparing ground bales to Baling square bales, it can be less labor as far as number of people, but yeah, I just got to come out and whip them all and haul them all and do all that, and then feed them all. It's still quite a bit of labor. So that's just kind of my thoughts on that. You know, if my dad or whoever's like, "Oh, I'm going to get a new square bale, and I better have some help." Well, the nice thing about square bales, you got 2-3 guys. You know, it's manageable, and you bale them, you load them on the wagon, you know, with the thrower, throw them on the wagon, take them down, put them in the mound, and you're done with them until you feed them. And then the thing is, just about anybody can pick the bale up, you know. So that's my thing on that. And the ground bales, you know, I'm out here baling them, and I got to come out and poop them all. And if I'm baling at another property, then I got to haul them all back. Use a ground bale wagon and haul them all back. You got to have a tractor to load, a tractor to unload, and a truck or tractor to haul in. It takes a lot of time. So, real quick about the ground baler. If you remember last year, I was having a little bit of a hard time getting it to trip to tie. And it was going past the trip arm. And I figured out after a little bit that I could take out the pin and I could rotate the cam and I could make it tie. And I kind of lifted through the end of the season last year that way. And I was trying to figure out, you know, what it was. Was it the linkage that was off? Is it the spring, the what, you know, I don't know what the problem is. So there's a spring and there's a pin on the cable. So the cable, the end of the cable has a pin and it's got all these holes in it. That's supposed to be how you set your bale size. So it was on, as far as I know, if I did it right, it was on the smallest bale, but we were still making pretty nice size bales. My thinking was that spring, over the years, of course, the belts are getting where they're stretched a little bit. And the other thing was, over the years, that spring had been stretched and it wasn't pulling the tension like it was supposed to. And it wasn't tripping it like it was supposed to. So today, I just had a couple minutes, and I was like, well, let me try this and see what happens. So I took it apart, and took the spring off, took it apart, and I slid a couple washers on. There is a washer that was cotter pin, safety pin type thing, and a washer. And so I took that off, and I put two washers on, put the pin back in. What I just noticed was that the stop up there, that's your bale size, I just noticed was that it stopped quicker than it did the other day when I was baling. So I might be making a slightly smaller bale. Whereas before, it was on the smallest thing, but the bales were still pretty good size. So what the problem is that is if it goes past the trip arm, then you make a bigger bale and you actually almost kind of get stuck in there. And I've had it do that before where it was hard to get the door open. You had to go back and actually hit the door latch with the hammer or something to get it unlocked. So I'm not sure if we're making smaller bales or not. We are just going to keep going for today. What I'm thinking was maybe I'll take out one of the washers and see if that's better. I'll probably bales here, I don't see where they're any smaller looking. So, and I guess that could be that if I have it on a smaller setting, but my spring stretched out, it could be that I might not get a smaller bale. I mean, they look pretty good to me. My main thing is that I just want to trip consistently and not have to worry about it. I mean, I'd rather make a smaller bale by, you know, a couple of inches than have to get out of the tractor and try to get it to trip and mess with it and fix it. Excuse me. Fix it all the time. And especially if I want to have somebody else bale, I can't just say, oh, here, go bale, and have the thing not work right. That's what always happens. You get somebody that help bale and they want to go do it, and they're like, oh yeah, here you go, that'd be a big help, you bale for me and I'll go mow hay or something, and then the next thing you know, it doesn't work right, and you're having to spend all the time fixing it anyway, and you don't get no hay mowed. That's kind of the way things go in the past. But the other thing is that you don't hear any beeping. Well, yeah, this baler, for whatever reason, I don't know what happened, but the monitor does not work. And one of the people I had bail for me one time, I'm pretty sure what happened was they actually ripped the wiring right out of the hitch. And I think it bent some of the prongs in there, the electronic things, in the plug, and messed it up. And I zip tied it and tried to get it to work, but there's actually pins missing, or they're bent or whatever, not making the connection. I'm not sure if that's the problem, whether that end is the problem or the tractor end is the problem or whatever. But so we're doing it old fashioned. I just go till the wheel starts spinning and I stop and tie a bale. Once in a while, I'm a little bit slow to do it. But what I did notice when I started doing it this way, boy, they always think they seem to tie better and still make it, it makes a good bale. So if it isn't like broke beyond the point where it doesn't work anymore, I guess we're just gonna keep rolling with it. But I got on eBay, I think it was last year, got on eBay, and I did buy a whole nother monitor for it. And actually I bought it because I wanted to be able to put it in another tractor so that I could have a backup tractor. This one's, you know, and if you're gonna take the time to wire it through the battery and run the wires up through the frame and all that, it's pretty nice. It'd be pretty nice just to have a whole other one to do it. We have two controllers for the square baler. Last year we actually square baled with two different tractors, and this year the square baler, the controller on the 966 wasn't working, and I had to switch the other one over to it, and we'll try to figure out what's wrong with that controller some other day, kind of thing, you know. But so we had a little bit of downtime here. We are going to dive into this ground baler a little bit. What I'm going to do first is I'm going to change out the tractor portion of the system, make sure that that's not the problem. And if that's not the problem, then I'm going to take that electronic lock off of this hitch. You can kind of see it through the PTO, the two wires, and runs right back into it. That's where that's kind of like the, I think it might actually be called the ECM or whatever. It's like the brain, like in a car. And then I'll take that off, and I think I priced it one time for $300. Whoop-dee-woo, right? Everybody wants to spend $300 on it. But boy, you can make nice bales without it. You just pay attention to what you're doing. And I mean, half the time you're driving, looking back anyway. Now, it is nice if you got it. You got the monitor, you can rely on it. You don't have to look back as much. Well, if you have the mirrors adjusted, so you can see those, the wheels that let you know you're tying. You can see those in the mirror. So they just drive around and they start spinning. And stop when they start spinning. But anyway, so this is going to go together with my square baling footage, and so we